Good morning, everyone. Now today we will study about quantum technology. Let's start with a brief history of the quantum technology. History of cement material is being use of the cement materials is being taken into account from the Egyptians time and the Indians, such as pyramids of Egypt, Harappa and Mohenjo-daro buildings from Indus Valley civilization. It is believed that cement materials being used in Egyptians and by the Indus Valley civilization in Harappa and Mohenjo-daro were used by burning gypsum. An analysis of the Great Pyramid that has shown that it contains 81.5% of calcium sulfate and only 9.5% of carbonate. That means if we have found that 81.5% of calcium sulfate is being used, that means it came from gypsum, the use of gypsum, because gypsum contains calcium sulfate in it. The Greeks and Romans were far more superior and intelligent than their contemporaries. They have used the limestone, which contains the calcium in it, and they have burned the limestone to make it into an adhesive material so that they can use in it their building. Romans, what they have done, they have used the volcanic ash or tuff, we can say. So they have used the volcanic ash or tuff or ash that is found near Pozzuoli village, a village near Mount Vesuvius in Italy. The volcanic tuff or the ash, as we call it, contains more amount of silica. It contains silica, that's why it is called as siliceous material. So this volcanic ash they came from the volcanoes which contain silica in it, and hence named as Pozzuolana. Why Pozzuolana? Because it is found in Pozzuoli village. So the name came from the Pozzuoli village. So this Pozzuolana name came from Pozzuoli village in Italy. Apart from this, Romans have also added blood, that is hemoglobin, milk and lard to their mortar and concrete to achieve the workability of the concrete, which they have made using these three materials and for liquids. Hemoglobin, as we all know through scientists, they have discovered that hemoglobin is a very powerful air entering agent and a plasticizer, which will affect the consistency, the workability of the concrete, which in turn will produce a much more durable concrete, which we have seen in many Roman structures. Now we'll talk about the Portland cement. The invention of Portland cement is attributed or done by Joseph Asprey, a Leeds builder. He has innovated the Portland cement, and the name Portland is taken from the place Portland in England, where the color of those stones which resembles the color of made concrete, a hardened concrete. That's why the name Portland comes from the place Portland, England, where the stone color is similar to the color of hardened concrete. In India, first of all, Portland cement was manufactured in 1904 near Madras in South India, where it is manufactured first, but unfortunately failed. Then second, in 1914, Indian Cements Corporation Limited established 100 tons of Portland cement at Porbandar, Gujarat. So this was the first time in India that the Portland cement is being manufactured. Now, the manufacturing of Portland cement. The raw materials required for manufacturing of Portland cement are calcareous materials and calcareous materials such as limestone or chalk, the calcareous materials which contains more amount of calcium in it, and argillaceous material such as shale or clay. Argillaceous materials are those materials which contains more amount of clay in it or silica in it. The process of manufacturing the cement consists of grinding the raw material. First of all, the manufacturing of concrete starts from the grinding of that material and intimate mixing of two different material, that is calcareous and argillaceous, and then feed that mixture, intimate mixture, into the kiln which is being maintained at the temperature of 1300 to 1500 degree Celsius, and then that after keep feeding this slurry which is made from the intimate mixture from the calcareous and argillaceous material, then when it comes out in the form of clinker, big clinkers, and then clinkers were then grounded and further added in a little mixture 3 to 5% of gypsum in it, as it, gypsum in it, so that it we can form Portland cement. Now there are two major processes of formation of or manufacturing of a cement, which are wet, dry, and these are the prevalent methods. One more method there is discovered, which is semi-dry. In semi-dry process, we use 10 to 14% of water in it, so that this 10 to 14% water will be used in a dry mix and added in that mix, and for after adding this, if we produce a cement from this, this process is known as semi-dry process. Now we will discuss about the wet process. First of all, the raw material or limestone is being taken from the quarries and loaded in the trucks and taken to the place where it is being grinded or converted into small particles, let's say crushing machine. Then after crushing, that is being the crushed material or limestone will be taken on conveyor to a storage plant where this powder form or like small particles, crushed form of limestone is kept. After this, the crushed limestone is being kept in the storage tank, again taken to the conveyor to the raw mill where it is grinded, and after grinding, the preheating is done of that raw material, which contains limestone as well as the clay in a proper mixture with the intimate mix. Then it is taken into preheating machine and it is preheated. Then that preheated the slurry is fed to the kiln, which is maintained at 1300 to 1500 degrees Celsius. And after that, the clinkers will come out, and after cooling of clinkers up to 200 degrees Celsius, then after cooling of the clinkers, we take clinkers outside and convert those clinkers into the grounded fine powder, and then powder again mixed with 3 to 5% of powdered gypsum, and ultimately it is gone. This mixture will go to the packing facility and it will be packed in that. So this is the packing facility, and this packing facility will be packed, and after packing facility this will be transported to the required consumer. Now the chemical compositions of the manufactured cement will have tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, tricalcium aluminate, and tetracalcium aluminum ferrite, which we refer to as C3S, C2S, C3A, and C4AF. The average composition of these silicates, tri, di, and tri aluminate, tricalcium aluminate, and tetracalcium aluminum ferrite will have these things in common. C, which here the C is denotes as the calcium oxide, which is we normally call as 9. Then S here denoted by silica dioxide, which is we normally name as silica. The A here is being denoted as alumina or aluminium oxide, and the F, which is here, is being denoted as iron oxide. So these four major compounds which we found in the cement after manufacturing of cement, this contains lime, silica, alumina and iron oxide in different compositions. So what happens inside the tin at 1300 degrees Celsius or more than that? The calcium oxide which comes from the calcareous materials and silicon oxide which comes from the argillaceous material, the raw material, is being fused at 1250 degrees Celsius to produce C2S. Likewise, the three molecules of CaO, calcium oxide, and one molecule of silicon dioxide is being fused at higher temperature and converted into C3S. Likewise, both for C3A and C4AF, which is tricalcium aluminate and tetracalcium aminoferrite. So, the chemical compositions of the raw material before manufacturing of cement and after manufacturing of cement, that is as a raw material and then after the manufactured compound of that cement. So first of all, the lime of the raw material which is being fed into kiln is contains lime 63%, silica 21%, alumina 6%, iron oxide 3% and other impurities as 7%. After making of concrete, the compounds which we have named earlier, like tricalcium aluminate, dicalcium silicate, tricalcium silicate and tetracalcium alumina ferrite is being formed, and these are in number 49% C3S, C2S is 25%, 12% C3A and C4F 6%, 8% and purity is 6%. So these are the pie chart which shows the formation and the amount of the different major compounds which are also named as Bogues compound. So the typical section which has been taken from optical microscope, which contains all four manufactured compounds, are shown. This is the photograph or the small picture of the microscope optical which are taken by the researchers to show how these C3A, C4AF, C3S and C2A where they are arranged in a lump of cement. Now we talk about heat of hydration. Normal cement heat of hydration in 7 days is about 89 to 90 calorie per gram, and about after 28 days it will be around 90 to 100 calorie per gram. The reaction in the early period of the hydration is a process where the water is mixed into cement, the mixture of cement, aggregate and the sand. So once water is mixed and comes into contact with cement, it will start a process which we name as hydration. And the heat generated in that process is the name as heat of hydration. It is generally exothermic reaction, so it gives heat outside from the reaction. Now after, as I said, after it has observed after 28 days of curing cement that hydrated grains are hydrated at the depth of only 4 micron, and the grains which are having a size of 50 micron are being hydrated. So it is being seen by the researchers that these things have taken place. Next is that the layer of hydrated silicate is being relatively impervious to water. The hydrated silicate which already been hydrated by the fusion reaction, or we say heat of hydration reaction. So why happens that only 4 micron layer is being hydrated? Because the already hydrated grains of cement were accumulated near the unhydrated grains, and they stop the hydration of the those unhydrated cement. That's why it is being only it's been found by research that only 4 micron depth of the grain is being hydrated. So what is the product of heat of hydration? The product of heat of hydration is this compound, which is calcium silicate hydrate, and this compound is the compound which has adhesive property, and because of this compound that produces after the heat of the hydration process is responsible for adhesion in the cement concrete. Apart from this CSH, as we name calcium silicate hydrate, one more compound is found named as CaOH choltroids, which is calcium hydroxide. So these two major compounds are formed after the hydration of cement. So these are the reactions: 2 molecules of C3S plus 6 hydrogen molecules, or we say H2O water molecules, fused together to form CSH, C3S2H3 plus 3 molecules of calcium hydroxide. If we take these into weight, so 100 gram of C3S fused with 24 gram of 6H, which gives 75 gram of CSH and 49 gram of CaOH choltroids. And if C2S, which is dicalcium silicate, is taken 100 gram and fused with the hydrogen, or like hydrogen representing H2O with 21 gram, gives 99 gram of CSH and CaOH choltroids as 22 gram. So what we have seen, these two major reactions of those compounds, that one produces only 75 gram and other produces 99 gram. That means C2S produces more adhesive than C3S. That's why we use higher content of C2S in cement where we need later strength or strength after some time. And C2S is used where we need initial setting or early strength. That's why we use C3S there. The cement which contains C3S more in amount. Also, C2S which hydrates and which is responsible for the later strength produces less heat of hydration, And if it produces heat of hydration, so there will be less shrinkage. That's why C2S is more superior than C3S. Now this is the hydration of potent cement reaction, which we have seen that, as I told you, C3S is a reactive compound, so it reacts quicker than C2S. So the initial heat is given by the reaction of C3S and C3A as well. So it is being given by reaction of C3A and C3S. After that, for some time, a dormant period will come. In this, there will be no movement, or like there will be no, this will be insensitive. The concrete will be in dormant period, in hibernation period. And after that, after some time, again the final setting or the later strength start to crop up. So initial heat is given by C3S and C3A, and the later heat, or we can say heat of hydration, is given by the hydration of C2S. Now if we take one by one the hydration of each compound, each porous compound, first of all we take the hydration process of C3S. This C3S will take 7H molecules or hydrogen molecules from H2O and fuse with C3H2H4, fuse with the hydrogen water and forms CSH gel along with CH, which is carbon calcium hydroxide. Same will be with C2S, which will take again the water, hydrogen molecule from water, and C2S from the Koch's compound, and forms CSH again gel, which I have already discussed earlier. if we see the hydration process of C3A without presence of sulfate or gypsum, there will be a product which is more unstable, which is C4AFH9 plus C2AH. So that product will be unstable, which is formed from C3A or tricalcium aluminate. Once it is unstable, it will try to stable itself. So it will stable and form into C3H2C3A6. And this reaction occurs very rapidly and releases a lot of heat. As I said earlier, that C3H is a reactive compound. C3A also is a very reactive compound, and it will, as soon as water is added into its cement, the first reaction will take place between the water molecules of the water and C3A, and then the next reaction will take place between C3S and the water molecules. So it gives a flash setting to the cement. So to reduce this, we add gypsum, which will retard its the process of the hydration, which is being started by C3A. So we use around 5 to 6% of gypsum in by weight of cement to retard the flash set of C3A. Now, if there is no gypsum supply in the cement, then there will be another compound which is formed, pectinate, and which is also an unstable compound, which will make itself stable after formation of monosulfate. So after pectinate formation, which is unstable, the monosulfate is formed, which is far more stable than pectinate. This is because the hydration of C3 to C3A in the presence of gypsum. So it will retard overall the telling about gypsum and the C3A. Is the summary of this is that if we add gypsum will retard the process, and it will ease the process with less heat of hydration generated by C3A when it will come into contact with water. Now the C4A is another bogus compound which will react with water and becomes unstable product. So why we discuss very less about the C4A? Because the C4A doesn't contribute anything in the process of making of concrete. Now this is how the pectinate looks like by the same optical microscope, and this is the pectinate, which is more fibrous fibrous in nature, and Ca calcium hydroxide or CaOH twice, which is much less fibrous than pectinate. That's why pectinate is unstable, because it is more fibrous, and CaOH twice is more stable because it is less fibrous in appearance. Now C3 and C4A compete for the same available sulfate ions. So once gypsum is added in cement, the cement being added into water, or like we make concrete of the cement after mixing of the cement, aggregate, and sand. If we add water into that, the same C4A and C4A will come in contact with water to compete for the gypsum, which is being prior added into cement during the manufacturing of cement. The advantages, gypsum is one more advantage, and the major one is that it will increase the reactivity of C2S and C3S. So now this is the hydration, again same diagram, which shows the hydration process. First, the hydration of C3S will take place, which gives more heat of hydration, so there will be more, and after that it will be dormant, and the period of dormancy will come, where concrete will be more less active, and after that again final set will come from the later strength of C2S, and after that C3A will have some more heat of hydration, and it will be then the again the process of the identity will start. So this is typically the formation of the compounds. First of all, see here the main thing is that when the water reacts with the calcium sulfates C2S and C3S, CSH is the first compound which will be formed. After this, it then will form, and then later calcium oxide and all these other compounds will form. This is, so this is the hierarchy in which the compounds will form after the addition of water into a cement, mixture of cement, sand and aggregate. So this is the strength contribution of each box compound. So the strength will be given by C3S, the initial strength will be given by C3S, the later strength will be given by C2S, and C3A and C4F will give comparatively less strength than these two, C2S and C3S. Now the oxides which contain in a cement after the formation of cement or manufacturing of cement. As you've seen it already, 64% CaO, 24% SiO2, 6% Al2O3 or aluminium oxide, 4% ferrous oxide, and then 0.5% magnesium oxide. So this is which we have already seen in the pie chart. Now these are the as I said, Bok's compound, the major compound which is formed after the manufacturing of cement, with the oxide composition of each abbreviation, as we have used a small form to represent this into C3S, and their approximate values, how much they are in significant. The function of each compound is that C3S is mainly responsible for early strength, which comes in 1 to 7 days. C2S is mainly responsible for later strength, which will come after 7 days and beyond. C3A gives flash shed in absence of gypsum, and if gypsum is added, it will retard the process of flash shed. And C4AF, it hydrates rapidly but doesn't add any strength into the concrete. So this is a schematic view of setting C3S. If we take C3 grain, it is initial set like this, and after this, final set will be like this, and the hardened paste will come into like this. So it will be an interlocking. Now, after the manufacturing of cement and the distillation of the Bok's compound, the major compounds after the formation of cement, we will go to the types of cement. There are 5 main types of cement according to ASTM C150, which are type 1 ordinary Portland cement, type 2 sulfate resistant or moderate heat cement, type 3 high early strength Portland cement, type 4 low heat cement, and type 5 sulfate resistant cement. So these 5 types of cement, they differ from their chemical compositions. There are also some basic other types of variations in the cements. They are type 1A, which is type 1 plus air entering admixtures, and likewise type 2A, 3A, 4A and 5A. So in the types of cement, we'll study about first of all type 3, which is high early strength Portland cement. Now, as I told earlier, if it is a high early strength Portland cement, then it should contain more amount of C3S, because C3S gives early strength in the concrete. So it will have more amount of C3S. And as its name, high early strength cement, 90% of the strength will come at the very less time, and the later strength will come after some more time. So high early strength Portland cement application is more in the places where we need high energy strength, that is in precast concrete or in the structures which they are in the structures where there is a necessary and requirement of precast structures. Type 4 is low heat cement. Low heat cement means the cement which produces low heat of hydration when mixed with water. Low heat of hydration means low amount of C3S and low amount of C3A. So if we have a cement which has C3S and C3A less in amount, then it should have C2S in more in amount, because it needs strength and the formation of CSH compound, which is an adhesive agent. So to form that, we need more amount of C3S, which will give later strength, and that gives the use of this cement that is being used in the places where we have to do mass concreting. Because if we do mass concreting, there will be more heat of hydration, there will be more heat generation, and it will be very difficult to handle that much heat if we use a normal cement. That's why at the places where we mass concreting, we will use low heat cement so that we can control the heat of hydration process. Also, if we have more heat generation, if we use normal cement, there will be a cracking of the cement and it will defeat the purpose of formation of a concrete. Next type will be type 5 sulfate resistance. This sulfate resistant cement will have lower amount of C3A and suitable areas of these cements are used in the suitable areas where we need this kind of cement. Sulfate resistant cement means where there is a necessity of a concrete after hardening to resist the sulfate. So the places especially where we will have more amount of sulfates in water or the environment, use this kind of cement. Now there are further more other different types of cement which were given by Indian Standard Codes. They are OPC, ordinary Portland cement, rapid hardening cement, sulfate resistant cement, Portland slag cement, quick setting cement, air retaining cement, expansive cement, high alumina cement, super sulfated cement, Portland cement, ready set cement, oil well cement, colored cement, low heat cement, and hydrophobic cement. We'll study about these cements one by one. First of all, the most common and important type of cement out of which other cements are derived, which is ordinary Portland cement. Ordinary Portland cements come in majorly three different grades, which are 33, 43 and 53 grade. As the grade of a concrete increases, the strength of the concrete increases after 28 days of curing. So this is being tested by Indian Standard 4031 1988 code. So the strength of 33 grade concrete after making from OPC or recruitment cement should not have 33 Newton per mm square, should not be less than 33 Newton per mm square of load. That means the if we make concrete cube of ordinary Portland cement, it should resist at least 33 Newton of load in its per mm square area. So that's why 33 grade name is given, because of the 33 Newton per mm square of compressive load resisted by that particular concrete. Again, if we say 43 grade and 53 grade, that means in 43 grade, 43 Newton per mm square of the pressure or load is resisted by the cube of the concrete, and if it's 53, then 53 Newton per mm square of load is being resisted by the concrete. as the grade of the concrete increases, the concrete becomes, the cement becomes expensive. So one disadvantage of these higher grades of cement is that they become expensive when the grades of the cement is increased. But they compensate that increase in amount into the strength they will give afterwards, which will be more than the ordinary coated cement of lower grade, and there will be some hidden benefits also. Now next is rapid hardening cement. Rapid hardening cement means which hardens rapidly. So rapidly hardening means which will have early strength, so it will harden early. So rapid hardening cement develops at the age of 3 days. At the age of 3 days only, rapid hardening cement develops its maximum strength, which in compared to ordinary coated cement will be at 7 days. The rapid hardening of galvanized strength is attributed to the higher fineness grinding of the cement grains, which is about 30 to 150 square centimeter per gram. So the higher the grinding of the cement, the more it will have specific surface area and more the probability of attracting water for the heat, for the triggering of the fusion process, so that it will produce more heat of hydration and the early strength. So rapid hardening cement will have more C3S content and comparatively less C2S content. So the rapid hardening cement gives out much greater heat of hydration during the early period, as it will have more C3S compound. The amount of compound C3S will be more. The more will be the heat of hydration and the early strength. So the application of this cement is where we need rapid hardening, such as road repairs and cold weather conditions and etc. There are many conditions we can use this road repair, cold weather, and where we have to use particularly this kind of concrete, rapid hardening concrete. Now rapid hardening cement is obtained by intergrinding the extra rapid hardening. Extra rapid hardening cement is contained by is produced by intergrinding of calcium chloride with rapid hardening potent cement. So rapid hardening potent cement, when it is combined with the calcium chloride, we get extra rapid hardening cement. As the name implies, it is an extra rapid hardening cement, and this kind of cement is used where we need extra rapid hardening, means where we have very less time of initial setting of the concrete. So for example, if this is like where we have more precipitation or say rainfall, so at those places we will have very less time and we will get less time to make concrete set. So we use this kind of concrete there, extra rapid hardening concrete. One major backlog of extra rapid hardening cement is that we have the storage time that cement will be very less, because it will be highly reactive. That's why the storage time is very less. The strength of extra rapid hardening cement is about 25% higher than the rapid hardening cement at 1 or 2 days, and 10 to 20% higher at 7 days. As the name implies, the extra rapid hardening is much hardens rapidly than compared to the rapid hardening cement. The gain of strength will disappear with age, and at the 90 days, the strength of extra rapid hardening of or the ordinary potent cement will be nearly the same. After the 90 days, the strength of extra rapid hardening and the OPC, ordinary potent cement, will be almost equal. That means this cement is only used for initial hardening, but the later strength of the concrete will be like this, and the OPC will be more or less equal. So this kind of cement is used at the places where there will be heavy precipitation and where we need like precast structures, where we need to make precast structures, especially example bridges, the girder set bridges. Now the sulfate resisting cement, which we have already seen in type the A-stain types, already potent cement is susceptible to the attack of sulfates. If we use already potent cement, it is susceptible to the attack of sulfate, in particular magnesium sulfate. So to resist that, we have to use sulfate resisting cement. Sulfates that both with the free calcium hydroxide in set cement to form calcium sulfate and with the hydrates of calcium aluminate to form calcium sulfur aluminate. If sulfates ingress into the cement, it will react with calcium hydroxide, which is the byproduct of the fusion reaction of C3S in the water apart from CSH. The product formed by reactions within the framework of hydrated cement will result in expansion and disruption. If sulfate attacks into your cement, it will start reacting with COOH, calcium hydroxide and calcium aluminate to form its salts, and that salts will be, or compounds will be more, will have a property of swelling and it will disrupt the structure. So that particular thing, when the sulfate ingress into the cement and reacts with calcium hydroxide and detroits the integrity of the concrete takes place, that phenomenon is called sulfate attack. So, and sulfate attacks always attack when it will ingress with the help of water. First of all, sulfate will mix into water, presence on the outer periphery of the concrete. Then once it will have enough space or like enough permeability of that concrete to ingress, it will go inside and attack the calcium hydroxide. So the remedy of sulfate attack will be the use of cement with low C3A content and low C3AF content. So if these two content will be low, then there will be behave as a remedy of the sulfate attack. The cement means to stop that attack of sulfate, the cement which we use will have a high silicate content and less content of C3A. And C3A, as we know, that it readily combines with sulfates, so we'll keep this C3A content to only 5% in sulfate resisting cement. Now next is blast furnace cement. Blast furnace cement is the cement which we will add the slag or like waste product which comes from the blast furnaces. The amount of blast, the granulated slag which is mixed in Portland clinker, will range from 25% to 65%. The quantity of slags mixed also will vary from 25% to 65%, and it varies from country to country, maximum up to 85%. So in a way we can say that minimum amount of the granulated slag used in blast furnace cement is about 25%, and the maximum is about 85%. So the early strength in this cement is mainly due to the clinker fraction, and the later strength is due to the slag fraction. So the clinker fraction, which is the potent cement fraction, the early strength is due to that fraction, and the later strength is due to the slag fraction. So it is like, as compared to the OPC, ordinary potent cement, in first 28 days, the concrete will be the concrete made up of this blast furnace will have a slower, like so much slower than the ordinary portion, means the hardening, the rate of hardening of that cement, the concrete which will be made from this slag cement will be comparatively less than the ordinary portion cement, but the end strength or the later strength after let's say 90 days will be almost equivalent to the ordinary portion cement or even may exceed from. The heat of hydration of the portland glass furnace cement is lower than the ordinary portland cement. So if the heat of hydration is less, then we can use this kind of cement into the dam construction, because there we need low heat cement, and the shrinkage cracks which will appear because of the high heat of hydration will be comparatively less. So the application is of this kind of cement will be to resistant to acid attack, so there will be more acid attack on the concrete. We can use this kind of cement there and can make buildings from it. So there in that concrete we have to just use 70% of the slag with OPC. If to counter sulfate and chloride attack, only 40-70% of granulated blast furnace slag is used with the already coated cement by weight. Now, quick setting cement. Quick setting cement is cement where it sets quickly. Like the C3A compound, we say it is a flash setting compound. The compound which presents in cement after manufacturing. So if we want to decrease the initial setting time of the concrete, we have to use this kind of cement which sets quickly. So how we can do, an earlier slide we have discussed that gypsum is a compound which retards the setting time of the concrete. So if we lower the amount of or reduce the amount of gypsum content at the time of clinkering formation, at the time of the combination of the clinkers and the gypsum, if we can reduce the gypsum at that time only, we can make the quick setting cement. So where is the application of this cement? The application of this cement is places where we will have the grouting, because once we do grouting has to be done in very low, like the pressures where the pressure will be high, and that particular quantity should also have some consistency in it or like workability, so it can go down into the cracks where we are grouting the concrete. So this cement, if you make a concrete of this cement, we can use it in the grouting operations. Now next is low heat cement. I think we have already discussed more about low heat cement. Low heat cement where the C3A amount, the amount of C3A and C3S are less. So now we will talk about low heat cement in different aspects as per the Indian Standard 12600/1989. The specific surface of low heat cement found by the air permeability method is not less than 32,000 square per centimeter per gram, and the 7 days strength of low heat cement is not less than 160 kg per centimeter square or 16 MPa or 16 Nm per m square, in contrast to the 22 MPa or 220 kg per centimeter square of ordinary portland cement. Next is portland pozzolana cement. We know that from where portland names come and from where the pozzolana name come. So basically the pozzolana is a siliceous material which we have already discussed that Romans have used it. The pozzolana content which we can use in a cement varies from minimum to 10% and not more than 25% by weight of the Portland cement. The compression strength of the cement should not be less than 220 kg/m² at 7 days and should not be less than 310 kg/m² at 28 days. The setting time of OPC is less than the setting time of the Portland cement. So the setting time of OPC is more than the OPC. Less amount of calcium hydroxide gives less pH value, but pozzolana improves permeability. As the calcium hydroxide amount will be less in PPC, so the pH maintained by calcium hydroxide will be less, and the permeability of the pozzolana will be improved because there will be less content of calcium hydroxide. Now next is hydrophobic cement. Hydrophobic cement is a cement where the grains of cement have a resistant film, like water resistant film in it, and which we use in the places where we need a cement which will repel the water. Example, the places where there will be more rainfall.